Thank you everyone for coming today. As Bob mentioned, what I'll be presenting today was my dissertation project, which has now segued into a book project. So I'll be presenting both quantitative research and also some of the qualitative research that I did while in the field as well. So there are two main questions in this project. First and foremost, I ask, just on the most basic level, where and when has sexual violence during civil wars happened? And I'm talking about modern day civil wars. My data set starts in 1980. There's a lot of still unanswered questions just about these facts on this most basic level when it comes to research on this question. Relatedly, I ask whether sexual violence varies by conflict, and this is important if we're going to study this question as a question of social science. We have to know whether or not there's variation on the dependent variable. So I first establish this variation in my research. Secondly, I ask why, even within the context of the same civil war, do some armed groups seem to commit a great deal of sexual violence, but other armed groups refrain from committing acts of sexual violence. So to put it this another way, I'm looking at variation both across conflicts and also within conflicts. So here's the outline of my talk today. I hope to talk for about 40, 45 minutes. First, I'll be addressing the motivation for this project and some of the silences in the previous research, particularly as it relates to violence against civilians during civil war. Secondly, I'll be turning to the dependent variable, variation in sexual violence during civil wars, and establishing that there is, in fact, variation both across conflicts and also within conflicts. I'll then be presenting my argument, which I call combatant socialization. And I've developed this argument based on literatures in psychology, sociology, criminology, and also borrowing a little bit from some of the economics literature on violence. I then address some of the alternative hypotheses that I pull out of the existing literature on violence against civilians during wartime, and also some of the common explanations that just kind of exist in the policy debates today, and try to test them against my argument in a quantitative analysis. I'll then present some of that analysis, and then look at the generalizability of the cross-national tests in some of the more specific cases. And I'll be talking today mostly about my research in Sierra Leone, which is the case where I spent the most time. I was in Sierra Leone for 6 months. But as Bob mentioned, I also did research in East Timor and in El Salvador. So although I'm not really going to be talking about that in the talk, I'm happy to answer questions about that later. And then finally, I'll conclude with some policy implications. So turning first to the motivation for the project, focusing here on the research in political science on violence against civilians or non-combatants during wartime, the research has really tended to focus on lethal violence, on homicide. And I've cited here some of the major studies in political science where these scholars have focused on lethal violence. And one of the reasons this is one of the reasons for this seems to be that lethal violence is simply easier to count than acts of non-lethal violence. Bodies are easier to count than sexual violence, where there may be repeated violations, it may be shameful to talk about, deaths are easier to count. But the scholars who work on these questions of violence against non-combatants often assume that there's a correlation between lethal and non-lethal violence. So even though these scholars are studying lethal violence, they will argue that their theories explain violence more generally against civilians during wartime. And I argue that they're not really explaining violence more generally, they're really explaining lethal violence. These scholars assume that there's a correlation between lethal and non-lethal violence, and so therefore there's not really a need to study both lethal and non-lethal violence, and I argue that that's really an empirical question. One of the things that we know from the existing literature is that homicide is not something that is randomly experienced by war-affected populations. We know that men are far more likely to be killed in wartime than are women. So really what has happened in the existing literature is that, particularly amongst political scientists, is that there's been sort of an unwitting study of violence against men during conflict. And we don't have a very clear picture of general violence against war-affected populations or violence against women in particular. And so that's where I see my research fitting into this gap in the literature. Sexual violence is a form of violence that most evidence would suggest mainly victimizes women. So these theories, which have been developed to explain homicide, I argue are unlikely to also be able to explain sexual violence, which affects an entirely or almost entirely distinct population than lethal violence. Looking at the research on wartime rape in particular, and this is both within the field of political science and more broadly, the research has tended to focus on case studies. And one of the problems with this is that it's really the same cases again and again. So Rwanda and Bosnia are studied over and over again with very little focus on sort of less well-known cases or less severe cases. There's been very few systematic studies where scholars will study a universe of, say, all conflicts within a particular study period. Some scholars also argue that sexual violence is ubiquitous, that it happens in every conflict, that there's really not a lot of variation to explain, it's just a byproduct of conflict. Other scholars say that there's really important variation between conflicts, that maybe Rwanda and Bosnia were extremely bad cases, other conflicts may be less severe, and I fall into this latter camp. I argue that there's quite substantial variation, both across and within conflicts. A final problem with some of the existing literature on wartime rape is that there is a tendency to select on the dependent variable. So there's a tendency for scholars to only study cases where they believe sexual violence has occurred and on a massive scale. There's not a sort of broader study of both cases where sexual violence was restrained, or negative cases, as one scholar calls them, in conjunction with cases that we believe to have had a massive incidence of sexual violence. And so this is not considered ideal research design in order to draw inferences about the causes. Finally, there tends to be a focus on state-perpetrated sexual violence. So we don't have a very clear idea on why or when or how rebels or insurgents, non-state actors in general, perpetrate sexual violence in the context of wartime. So to start to look at some of these questions, I collected a data set which, as part of the dissertation, included the years between 1980 and 1999, and those are the results I'll be presenting today. I'm in the process, I'm almost finished, expanding the data set another 10 years to 2009, so it'll be slightly more current for the book project. And I'll be presenting the results for the whole data set, the 1980 through 2009, in the political science department this coming spring. So if you're interested in how the results may or may not have changed, I encourage you to come to that talk. But for today, I'll be focusing on the first part of the data, which goes between 80 and 99. I use a relatively restrictive definition of sexual violence, which essentially looks mainly at rape. Other scholars use much broader definitions of sexual violence that can include sexualized insults. I have a colleague who studies sexual violence in Peru, and she includes the forced shaving of women's heads. But I use a very restrictive definition of sexual violence, which is essentially rape. I collected data from the annual U.S. State Department Human Rights Country Reports, which are issued every year since 1975 by the State Department, which report on human rights practices by all countries. And these include sexual violence. It also includes all sorts of human rights. So from these annual reports, these sort of qualitative descriptions, I coded a four-point scale of what is essentially the intensity of sexual violence, which ranges from 0 to 3, 0 meaning that there were no reports of war-related sexual violence in a particular conflict year, all the way to 3, where sexual violence was described as massive, widespread, systematic, with 1 and 2 being sort of intermediaries between there, so isolated or numerous reports. And I think this particular method has a benefit in the sense that these are data coded out of the same source over time. And so there's a presumed consistency in how the State Department collects their data and how they report on the extent of violence. This can be a somewhat debatable point, and I'm happy to talk about that in the question and answer session. There are, as I just mentioned, a variety of potential biases. Some scholars have noted that the U.S. State Department may not always be the most objective reporter of human rights practices.
Neutral.
Yeah, thank you. There also are problems with looking at data that is collected in the year that it happened, as opposed to looking at more historical data or retrospective data, in the sense that victims may be not very willing to talk about violence as the conflict is ongoing. But in my research, and along with actually two of the students in this room, we've been looking at, as sort of a related project, at other sources of potential sources to collect this type of data out of, including an annual report that's issued by Amnesty International every year. And it does seem that the State Department is the most comprehensive and the most detailed as compared to a variety of other potential sources. So I think this is, in a sense, the best we can do in terms of looking for annual data on sexual violence. So as I said, this is a measure of the relative magnitude or intensity of sexual violence over time. And to sort of foreshadow some of the results here, I find that there is substantial variation by conflict and by armed groups within conflict, which again is important if we're to study this question as a social science research question, establishing this variation. So looking just at the distribution of the dependent variable, and as I mentioned, this ranges from no reports to isolated reports, numerous reports, and widespread reports, and this is at the conflict level. There are 71 conflicts in this period. I've noted the set of conflicts that were coded as having the worst sexual violence during their particular civil war. To people who study sexual violence during civil war, there really are probably no surprises with this collection of worst case conflicts. So looking at other forms of variation on the dependent variable, there was some very interesting regional variation. Sub-Saharan Africa is often considered a place where sexual violence during wartime is maybe particularly common. But I found that as a proportion of the civil conflicts that occurred in this period, sexual violence actually had a lower or smaller proportion of civil wars with the worst level of rape than did Eastern Europe. And these are very small numbers, but I thought this was a particularly interesting finding. There's also variation over time. Sexual violence during wartime was reported as early as 1981, and my data collection again starts in 1980. And this is quite interesting because there really was a policy focus on sexual violence during wartime in kind of the post-Bosnia era. But we do see reports, even when there wasn't a large amount of policy interest in this issue, as early as 1981. Starting around the time when the sexual violence in the Bosnian War was becoming more well known, we do see that there are reports of the worst level of sexual violence starting in 1991, and that has continued every year thereafter. So this does provide some evidence that some scholars have argued that sexual violence during wartime does seem to be getting worse in recent years. So this does provide some evidence for that claim. The last type of variation that I found that was very interesting, and I'm still kind of struggling over how to make sense of this in terms of my theory and the book project, is that there was some very interesting variation in perpetrator type. So I looked, I divided actors into state actors and non-state actors. And I found that of the conflicts that had some level of sexual violence, so not including the conflicts that there was no sexual violence reported, about half had both state and non-state perpetrators. 30% had only state perpetrators, and 15% had only insurgent perpetrators. So it does seem that states are more likely, state actors, so armies, militaries, are more likely to use sexual violence than are insurgencies or rebels, which is kind of an interesting form of variation that, as I said, I'm still puzzling over. One of the things I also discovered in this coding project is that the venues in which states seem likely to commit sexual violence often seems to be in the context of detention. as a form of abuse against detainees, suspected insurgents or suspected guerrillas. So sexual violence seems to be used in that context in particular. So after establishing that there is, in fact, variation both across and within conflicts, I then develop an argument, which again I call an argument about the process of combatant socialization. I argue that sexual violence is often, but not always, a unit-level phenomenon within an armed group used as a socialization practice by fighters, and I'll explain a little bit more about what I mean by that. I argue that the level of cohesion within an armed group unit is an important predictor or determinant of the level or the amount of costly group violence that that group produces. And in this case, I'm thinking in particular of sexual violence and even more in particular of gang rape. One of the puzzles, which I'll also talk about in a few minutes, about wartime sexual violence is that much of the violence seems to take the form of gang rape. Or at the very least, our best evidence suggests that there is a marked increase in the amount of gang rape during wartime when we compare it to the amount of gang rape during peacetime. And so any explanation for wartime sexual violence, any robust explanation, really needs to be able to account for why we see this increase in group sexual violence in particular. So that's really what I've focused my argument on and much of my research on. So at the bottom of the slide, I have just a very simple logic of the argument, where I argue that forced recruitment in particular, so when fighters are abducted or press ganged in the case of state militaries, can help us understand the level of social cohesion within an armed group unit. So in cases of forced recruitment, this would mean that there was relatively low levels of social cohesion within the armed group unit, which then can lead to the violence outcome of costly group violence as a means for maintaining and creating social cohesion within within the unit, as a means of creating trust between the fighters, as creating bonds of loyalty. So this argument draws on a variety of literatures in a variety of disciplines, including economics, sociology, and political science. But the argument is the same across these disciplines. Scholars have noted that institutions with constant influxes of new members or strangers, and I think probably even more specifically, involuntary influxes of new members and strangers, will turn to costly group violence as a means to organize the structure of the group or to have the members of the group signal their type to other members in the group to create bonds also between members of the group. And scholars have noted this phenomenon within the context of armed groups, but also within the context of street gangs and prisons as well. And one of the few studies that, one of the few existing studies that I think relates quite nicely to this argument is a study that was done in the Canadian Air Force, where a scholar studied what she called the non-conventional methods for promoting unit cohesion within the Canadian Air Force. In this case, the members of this particular unit of the Canadian Air Force jump out of planes. They have this grave need to trust each other. And she finds that there are these harmful, often sexualized bonding practices that the members of the Canadian Air Force have used in order to create these bonds of loyalty and trust to one another. So as I mentioned, this is one of the few studies that I found that traces this mechanism in a different context. So one of the pieces that I argue in this project is that gang rape is a form of costly group violence. And this itself is contrary to much of the literature on sexual violence during wartime. Rape is, in the literature, often treated as a relatively costless weapon from the perspective of the perpetrator or the perpetrating group. But I argue that the risks for perpetrators and armed groups, perpetrating armed groups, have really been overlooked in the literature. And one of the most interesting findings that I had from my research in Sierra Leone is that sexually transmitted disease was rampant in that conflict, and in particular syphilis and gonorrhea. And so fighters were participating in acts of gang rape and contracting these illnesses with very little and mostly no access to drugs to treat these illnesses. And so illnesses like gonorrhea and syphilis actually rendered the fighters unable to walk or to run. It hurt the military capability of the armed group. So this, in a sense, is, well, this is one of the main costs, I argue, from the perspective of the perpetrating group. Some of the other costs, I think, that have been overlooked is that gang rape takes longer to commit than other types of violence. And this may seem like a trivial point, but in the context of a conflict, why gang rape as opposed to something that's maybe easier to commit against against victims? And finally, there was some evidence in my interviews that the intimate contact that's required to commit an act of rape may carry a greater emotional toll for the perpetrators than other types of violence. So again, these are some costs that are specifically associated with committing an act of rape in the context of wartime. One of the last important findings, which comes out of the criminological literature on peacetime gang rape, and there's very little research on this, even in the context of peacetime, is that the perpetrators of gang rape in peacetime seem to be fundamentally different from the perpetrators of single rape or low perpetrator rape. Criminologists tend to treat perpetrators of gang rape as more similar to perpetrators of other types of group crime than they do to perpetrators of single rape, who tend to be more pathological than perpetrators of group rape. And I think this sheds some interesting light on why, on one of the kind of big puzzles when it comes to wartime rape, in particular with abducted combatants who are really just ordinary people. How is it that ordinary people, once they're abducted into an armed group, can commit sexual violence on such a massive scale when they would have refrained from doing so during peacetime? I think this literature sheds some light on that question. So the basic idea here is that the desire for an abductive combatant to fit in to his or sometimes her armed group is a powerful motivator for group violence, of which gang rape is a type. So I argue that conditional on being trapped in an armed group as an abducted combatant, the benefits of cohesion, and I don't mean cohesion in the sense of friendship per se, but just some of the cohesive benefits such as access to food or protection in the context of a civil war may outweigh some of these costs that I've just outlined of rape and the continued estrangement that an abducted combatant may feel from his or her peers. So I think this particular argument can shed some light on some of the central puzzles that exist about wartime rape. First of all, why does wartime rape frequently take the form of gang rape, as I just mentioned, when gang rape is a relatively rare form of peacetime violence? Secondly, how is it possible that seemingly ordinary people, once they are forced into armed groups, can commit acts of brutal violence, and in this case, brutal sexual violence, on such a large scale? And I'll talk about this in the context of the Sierra Leone War in a moment. And finally, how do we account for the involvement of female perpetrators? And this is, again, one of the really interesting findings that I had from my fieldwork in Sierra Leone, where, and I'll talk more about this when I talk about the case, but the armed group that did the majority, that perpetrated the majority of the sexual violence in the Sierra Leone War, was also the armed group that had the most female combatants. By some counts, it was 25% to 30% female. And these women would often participate in the gang rape of female non-combatants. So how do we account for the involvement of female perpetrators in the rape of non-combatant victims? And this is not isolated to the case of Sierra Leone. Recent research has also found evidence for female perpetrators in the DRC. There was just a Journal of the American Medical Association article that found victims reporting that they had been violated by female perpetrators. Also in the Truth and Reconciliation Commission testimonies in Liberia, there was evidence of female perpetrators there as well. And in some of the earlier work on Rwanda, women being involved in the genocidal rape there as well. So again, it's not limited only to Sierra Leone. All right, so moving from my argument to some of the other potential sources of cross-national variation, which I've pulled out of the literature from political science, but also some of the literature from other disciplines and some of the kind of conventional wisdom about where and some of the causes of sexual violence. Scholars have argued that sexual violence is more likely in a set of circumstances. So first, scholars have argued that sexual violence is more likely in ethnic conflicts. And I think these scholars are, in particular, are relying on some of the lessons that they've learned from studying Rwanda and Bosnia, which of course were ethnic wars. And so some scholars have argued that ethnic tension seems to make, or ethnic hatred seems to make sexual violence more likely in the context of civil war. Other scholars have argued in a variation on this that secessionist wars in which opponent sides want to send a signal that life together is finished will use sexual violence as a method for communicating that. Other scholars argue that sexual violence seems to be particularly likely in the context of genocide. And again, I think scholars are often relying on Rwanda as a case here. Scholars have argued that sexual violence is more likely in countries with greater gender inequality. And I think this is one of the most common conventional wisdoms, particularly in the human rights advocacy communities, where those advocates will often point to women's insecurity or the lack of political, social, and economic rights for women during peacetime, which makes them at risk for sexual violence during wartime. And finally, I test one of the central arguments in political science right now, which is an argument by Jeremy Weinstein, where he argues that insurgencies that are funded by contraband, such as diamonds or drugs, seem to be more likely to victimize non-combatants than are insurgencies that rely on other methods for garnering their fighters. So again, I try to test these arguments against one another in a quantitative study. I collected data on the dependent variable. It's a four-level variable. I also collected, I disaggregated this data by looking at the level of perpetration by perpetrator group type. So I looked at whether states were reported to have committed that sexual violence or whether non-state actors were. I collected a new variable on how the armed group had recruited their fighters, and I'm arguing that this variable is a proxy for the level of internal cohesion within a group. So I essentially asked, were there ever reports of forced recruitment by this particular armed group? I can talk a little bit about how I coded that particular variable if you're interested in the question and answer. But I looked at both forms of abduction or coercion as a form of forced recruitment on the part of the insurgents. And also I looked at press ganging on the part of states, which may seem like a very antiquated practice, but actually happened with some frequency in this study period, which was a surprising finding, where essentially states would go in and just kidnap, for example, a cinema full of people and force them to join the Salvadoran army. So this does happen with surprising frequency. So the sample in the study are the 71 civil wars between 1980 and 1999, which yielded 654 conflict years. I use a variety of other variables from the literature and also some control variables, which I won't go through right now, but there they are. And I conducted a statistical analysis where I looked at three different dependent variables depending on the unit of analysis that was necessary depending on the type of hypothesis I was looking at. So I looked at both the conflict level sexual violence, so whether sexual violence had ever been reported in a particular war, and if so, how bad was it? And I also kind of disaggregated the blame for that had a dependent variable looking at the sexual violence that was perpetrated by state actors and the sexual violence that was perpetrated by non-state actors. And I estimated an ordered probit, and I clustered the standard errors by conflict. I'm not putting on the screen the regression table, but the upshot is that the conflict level results suggest that sexual violence is not well explained by ethnic war. I looked both at codings for ethnic war and also for different robustness tests looking at kind of ethnic diversity and also religious fractionalization. None of these variables were significant. Genocide also was not significant. The aim of the war, so whether it was a secessionist war, again, not significant. And the number of battle deaths was also not significant, which is an important finding given how I explained the previous literature, which is that many of the previous scholars have argued that we don't really need to study forms of non-lethal violence if we're studying forms of lethal violence. And so this suggests that we require a different explanation for deaths than we do for sexual violence. What I did find on the conflict level is that shorter wars seem to predict sexual violence, lower GDP, and also lower fertility rates, which is a sort of confusing finding. So I use fertility rates as a proxy for understanding the level of gender equality within a particular country. And I found, contrary to what the prediction would be, that lower fertility rates, so higher gender equality, seem to predict sexual violence, which is, again, a kind of confusing finding that I'm puzzling through. So looking at the other two dependent variables, kind of disaggregating the blame for the sexual violence within the conflict, looking at sexual violence that was perpetrated by insurgents and how we might explain that, I did find that ethnic variables do seem to explain sexual violence perpetrated by insurgents. So there is some support for the ethnic war hypothesis, as long as that sexual violence is being perpetrated by insurgents. Shorter wars seem to be more likely to feature sexual violence. I did find some support for Jeremy Weinstein's theory on contraband funding, that insurgent groups that rely on diamonds and drugs seem to be more likely to commit sexual violence. And finally, I found some support, also some strong support for my variable of interest, which was forced recruitment, which again, I argue is a proxy for the level of cohesion within a particular armed group. Lastly, for the state-perpetrated sexual violence, which, as I mentioned before, looking at the dependent variable, the states seem to perpetrate sexual violence on a much larger scale than do insurgent groups. I found very little that was significant for state-perpetrated sexual violence beyond larger populations. So states. Militaries within states that have larger populations seem to be more likely to use sexual violence during wartime. And almost significant, but not quite, was my variable of interest again, which was press ganging, which would be the equivalent of abduction by an armed group. So looking at the substantive results of these findings, I find that moving from a state of no forced recruitment to a state of forced recruitment by a rebel group increases the likelihood that that group will use sexual violence by about 3 times, controlling for a variety of the control variables, as is outlined on the bottom of that slide. And similarly, moving from a state of no press ganging to a state of press ganging increases the likelihood that a state military, will use sexual violence during wartime by about 1.5 times. So these are not enormous effects, but they do suggest that the recruitment mechanism does seem to have an effect on the violence outcome. So moving from the cross-national results to the micro level, it's fair to ask the question about how generalizable is this argument, or how does it function on the micro level? So in addition to this cross-national analysis, I conducted field work in 3 cases, and these were cases that were selected according to the logic of research design logic, which I'll explain in a moment. But the case where I focused most of my fieldwork energy was Sierra Leone, which I chose because it was a case where there was a high degree of sexual violence, and the main perpetrators of the sexual violence were the insurgents, or the rebels in that particular case. I also visited East Timor, which again is a case of high sexual violence, but in this case, most of the sexual violence was perpetrated by the Indonesian military, so state perpetrators. And lastly, I conducted interviews in El Salvador, which was a case of relatively low, although not zero, sexual violence, and again, the Salvadoran military were the perpetrators in that case. So there's variation on the dependent variable amongst the cases I selected, and also variation in terms of the perpetrating groups. So in these each of these cases, I conducted interviews and focus groups with former fighters, so those who had served in the military or the insurgency in that particular conflict, and also conducted interviews with non-combatants. So in that sense, I was thinking of trying to locate essentially potential victims. I didn't seek out interviews with victims. I didn't say I wanted to interview victims of sexual violence, but as I'll explain in a moment, I randomly selected villages around the country and spoke to people whose, what I said was, lives were affected by the conflict, and I let the village decide what that meant to them. Often because in Sierra Leone the sexual violence was so widespread, there were people that I was interviewing who had been sexually violated. And I can talk a little bit more about the interview process if you're interested. So the purpose of these interviews, again, was to explore this mechanism on the micro level and to really see if there was evidence for whether sexual violence promoted cohesion within within the armed group unit, and also look for whether there was any evidence of the observable implications of this theory on the ground. So looking at my research strategy in Sierra Leone in particular, I visited Sierra Leone three times between 2006 and 2008 for a total of 6 months in the field. And as I said, I visited randomly selected villages, and I also purposely selected strategic towns, and including the capital, to conduct interviews. And I used some previously available survey evidence as well, which I can talk about if you're interested. So looking in particular at the interviews I conducted in Sierra Leone, I interviewed 210 people, and these were not representative in any sense, in any statistical sense, I should say, but I sought to interview representatives of each of the major combatant groups, each of the major armed groups, including the RUF, which was the major rebel group, the CDF, which was a kind of quasi-governmental paramilitary organization, the Sierra Leone Army, the SLA. I also spoke to non-combatants and to NGO representatives. And I conducted these interviews both in a one-on-one format and also in the context of focus groups, which is a method I decided on, the focus group method, particularly for interviewing villagers. All of the interviews with ex-combatants were conducted in a one-on-one format, but for interviewing villagers, I decided to conduct focus groups because I found it to be helpful for the villagers to sort of remind each other in the context of a focus group about some of the details about what had happened in their village over the context of the war, particularly because I was conducting these interviews years after, in some cases, years after their own experiences or the village had experienced wartime violence. So these were a semi-structured interview format in the sense that I asked the same questions in the context of an interview, of a conversation, and to each person about their experiences with violence as a fighter or their experiences with violence as a non-combatant. And I can talk a lot more about how I did these if you're interested. So what did I find in Sierra Leone? I found that most of the rape, and I should say this is, of course, rape that was reported to me, so there can also be some potential systematic biases in what the kinds of rape that get reported versus the kinds of rape that don't get reported, etc. We can talk more about that as well. But I did find that most of the rape in Sierra Leone seems to have been gang rape, so multiple perpetrators and single victims. A lot of the rape also was public, and I think this is an important observable implication of my argument, because if rape is intended to have this bonding function, then there has to be an audience for this to happen. So it was public in the sense that it was in front of other combatants, certainly. It was sometimes in front of the victim's family members or in front of other villagers as well. But this public aspect is an important implication. As I mentioned earlier, there were participants of both sexes. So there's nothing in my argument that would require that there are only, for example, male perpetrators and female victims. I did not find a lot of evidence that there were male victims of sexual violence, and this again can be part of the potential reporting bias, that as difficult as it is to collect data on sexual violence against women, it's extremely difficult to collect data on sexual violence against male victims. So there were, I think, two male victims that were reported to me in amongst the many, many dozens of female victims. So I don't have a very good sense of sexual violence against men, but there, at the very least, there were perpetrators of both sexes. So I interviewed female perpetrators of sexual violence along with male perpetrators of sexual violence. I found that the group that abducted the most combatants also committed the most sexual violence, and there's some important temporal variation as well, which I unfortunately don't have the slide here, but that as I have data on the recruitment practices of the RUF over time, and I find that that closely tracks with their reported, the sexual violence that was reported to have been committed by the RUF as well. And this is despite the fact that there were more female fighters in this group. One of the kind of common arguments that is often made in the policy community, and I find this is especially true in the conversations about peacekeeping troops, that if we have more female peacekeepers, we are less likely to see what we might consider bad male behavior or sexual violence by peacekeepers. And I would argue that there is actually very little evidence to suggest that that is true, that having a minority of female fighters fight alongside men really probably doesn't have a very strong effect on the kinds of things that male combatants do. And this is certainly a piece of anecdotal evidence, at least from the Sierra Leone War, that would suggest that the presence of women does not prevent sexual violence against other women. I found that, that I did find evidence that the gang rape was cohesive, that often fighters, and I'll in a couple of slides show you some of the interview evidence that I collected, but that fighters would often talk about their participation in gang rape as something that brought them closer to the people that they were perpetrating the rape with. But it was not, this was distinct from other forms of violence. So when fighters reported having committed, say, looting or mass killing, there wasn't the same kind of mutual esteem that seems to have built as there was when they were describing having participated in acts of group rape. I found that rape was something that was organized from the bottom of the units, which again I think is something that is very important. So I tried very hard to look for evidence that rape was used as a tool of war, as it is often described to have been used in conflicts in general, and certainly in the case of Sierra Leone. So what might it mean for rape to be used as a tool of war? I was hoping to, or expecting, I should say, to find evidence that rape was something that was ordered, that rank and file fighters would describe that either they or someone they knew had been ordered to rape, that commanders perhaps would admit to either themselves or someone they knew, another commander level, having ordered their fighters to rape. I found this rarely to be true. Commanders rarely reported this, rank and file fighters rarely reported this. So it does seem to have been something that was bottom up as opposed to top down, which again is quite counter to a lot of the conventional wisdom about rape being used as a tool of war, something from the top down, which is not to say that never happens, but I think probably rape being organized from the bottom up is something that's more common than rape being ordered from the top down. And finally, I found some important in-case variation. This paramilitary group called the CDF, the Civilian Defense Forces, actually had some change over time, where initially they were recruiting fighters through kinship ties. And over time, they began to recruit fighters more in methods that more similarly reflected the RUF. They began to abduct their fighters. And we can also see some variation in terms of the types of violence they committed. The CDF committed very little sexual violence at the beginning of the war, and then more towards the end of the war, they began to commit, although nowhere near at the level that the RUF did, but there is evidence that they began to commit more acts of gang rape as they began to abduct their fighters. I'm running out of time, so maybe I will rush through some of these slides here. But here's some of the interview evidence that I collected in Sierra Leone. One former RUF fighter was explaining this process of social pressure within the combatant group, and he said, "The new guys never wanted to rape, but they were mocked and treated like they were not serious rebels, and after a few months, they got used to it." The second quotation here is from a former RUF fighter, and she was explaining this process of how women could become involved in acts of gang rape. And she said, "Women rebels would often begin involved in the rapes. Some of the women RUF would hold onto the victims' hands, would use bottles and sticks. The women did not feel any mercy for their victims." This is again evidence that female fighters behave in ways that are quite similar to male fighters, given similar circumstances. So what are some of the policy implications of this research? I think that forced recruiting by armed groups can possibly serve as a warning sign, an early warning sign for sexual violence. One of the things that I'm looking at as I'm continuing to collect data, it seems that forced recruitment, which is something that I've also collected data on in addition to sexual violence, seems to be reported earlier than sexual violence does in the course of a conflict. And so this may be because forced recruitment is less shameful or more likely to be reported in general. So I argue that reports of forced recruitment maybe can serve as an early warning sign to policymakers who are interested in mitigating sexual violence during wartime. It can possibly also influence U.S. support in terms of which sides to support in the context of civil war. There are also some important implications for international law. In this, first, the kind of chain of command evidence that is often hoped for, I guess, by international law advocates is probably likely to be rare. This idea that we're going to be able to trace an order from the top down to commit acts of sexual violence, I think, is probably going to be quite rare. But I do think it's even given that, still important to hold commanders responsible for the behavior of their rank and file fighters, even in the absence of these types of orders. And one of the kind of other legal implications, I think, is to begin to take more seriously female combatants as armed actors, not simply as sexual slaves, as they're often treated in the context of the Sierra Leone conflict, not simply as cooks or porters, but also as armed actors who commit acts of wartime violence. And I think there's sort of two parts to this. First, women right now don't tend to benefit from DDR programs, from disarmament, demobilization, and reintegration programs. They don't receive the health services, they don't receive the money often that male combatants do, because they're not often seen as fighters in the way that men are. But the flip side of this is that women should also start to be held more accountable for the war crimes that they seem to be perpetrating. So there's kind of two elements there. So in conclusion, the analysis here suggests that there may be a new mechanism to explain variation in sexual violence during wartime. And I want to make clear that this argument, the combatant socialization argument, cannot explain every case of wartime sexual violence. And nor is it an argument that every time recruits are forced into a group that they will use gang rape against non-combatants. But I do present evidence that this argument explains variation both across conflicts and within conflicts better than many of the rival explanations, including some of the common conventional wisdom. Right. Thank you.
Thank you, Dara. Conversation about this. Comments, questions.
Dara, did you take age into consideration in looking at the combatants, the soldiers?
In what sense? When I selected interview subjects, or
no? In the sense of the whole study, my sense would be the younger the age, the greater the incidence of violence. Just as, I don't know why I have that impression, that less experienced folks. there anything there that would make any sense?
I didn't collect systematic data on age, and I was also limited my IRB approval, my human subjects approval, was only to interview adults. And so, although that may not have been such a big problem, because I was interviewing people years after the war had ended in some cases, so if they had been very small children at that time, they may not have been active armed fighters in general. I do think there probably is an argument to be made that children are more susceptible to the kinds of peer pressure that we see in these sorts of cases where there's a lot of pressure to commit these acts of group violence, including gang rape. But I didn't really collect systematic data on age.
Were you thinking more about the difference between somebody who's 18 and somebody who was 35?
Well, that too. I was wondering, for example, with U.S. troops, comparing a Vietnam with an Iraq war and conscription with the National Guard, and I'd be curious to see if there were any distinctive differences in those groups, one being a more community-based soldiering group that are being conscripted as a group, as opposed to people being put in a selective service system. So yeah, both.
Two quick questions. One, did you notice a common victimology in terms of both within and then among the whole? Were the same type of women? And then the other thing I was curious about was the State Department and gathering the data. How is it that they get their data? I just can't imagine them calling up saying, you know, we'd like some information, could you give us your numbers? And we work a lot with trafficking, and we know so much of just gathering the data for so many reasons is, it's just off. You know, countries don't want to come forward with that.
So in terms of the types of victims, one of the things that I was looking for and when I first started the research in Sierra Leone was, again, this evidence that sexual violence had been used as a tool of war, which would suggest that victims were selected for a particular reason. So in some cases, this might be because they're of a particular ethnicity or religion, or that they were allied with the opponent in the conflict. I did not find evidence of this at all in Sierra Leone. The kind of main the main feature that a lot of the victims seemed to have was that they were women. There was a range of ages, including very young victims and very old victims, but most of the victims were kind of appropriate marriageable partner age, given the general ages of the combatants. But there did not seem to be a lot of evidence that victims were selected because that they were aligned with a particular ethnicity or that sort of thing. The Sierra Leone War wasn't an ethnic war, which is another reason why I selected these particular conflicts that I ended up studying, because I was trying to test, these are in some sense are hard cases for a lot of the existing theories to explain, the theories that were developed out of Bosnia and Rwanda, because these are non-ethnic wars. And the armed groups in Sierra Leone are very similar demographically speaking. So the ethnicities and tribal affiliations were kind of spread across the armed groups. There wasn't clear delineations between the armed groups, I should say. In terms of the State Department data, I think I have a slide on this, but
I turned you off. Sorry.
maybe I'll just.
Just in general, I was curious how forthcoming, you know, countries would be with that information and how in general the State Department would get that.
So that's a great question. It's actually, the State Department, these annual reports don't have a very clear methodology section in them. So I actually went to Washington and interviewed the people involved in some of the editors of this report about the process by which they collect this data. Basically, the reports have been collected since 1975, and it's a congressional mandate to collect this particular data and to produce this particular report. And so the kind of central office in Washington sends a description of what they're looking for to each of the field offices and asks them to collect data on all sorts of human rights practices. and have them send back that information to kind of main states. But it's people within the State Department that are writing the reports. And they rely on just a huge variety of sources. So local NGOs, Human Rights Watch, Amnesty International, local journalists. There aren't footnotes in these reports, and they're not very clear about each specific report, but in general they have a list of about 20 different types of sources that aren't on my slide, about the different ways that they collect this kind of information. And as I said, I think they actually in general do a very good job of collecting this data, at least as compared to almost every other source that I've tried to consult. And certainly they're the only institution that collects this data on a regular annual basis. There are other organizations like Human Rights Watch, which will do a very long, very detailed report on sexual violence in Sierra Leone, but that comes at once, and it's sort of about the sexual violence over the entire course of the conflict. So if you're interested in variation across time, that doesn't help very much.
Dara, I wanted to ask two questions if I could. One about the mechanism, the cohesion mechanism, and the other is sort of methods, effects, possibilities. The group cohesion mechanism, I would think one would assume, at least sort of a priori, that if this is a sort of functional apparatus, as you've at least implicitly described it, right? That there would be some, if you will, diminishing or decreasing marginal utility to this, right? That is, that with each additional gang rape, you get a smaller and smaller increment to group cohesion. Is there any evidence for that? In other words, that it seems to me would be partly a check on the degree to which this group cohesion. Is it the contrary? That is this an escalating function, right? And if it is an escalating function, is that entirely compatible with the sort of group cohesion thing per se, right? So that would be just a general question about the theorization of that mechanism. The other that's the more methods effect kind of question would be, if you haven't, would it make sense for you, do you think, to have someone that is a methods effect in terms of this reliance on State Department data that we sort of joked initially when you presented it about its objectivity or neutrality and so forth. Would it make sense for an independent coding, that is, someone who has no knowledge of what it is that is reported about the sexual violence, but to have an independent coding of each of these armed groups' relationship with the U.S., that is, the degree to which the State Department sees them as, sort of friendly group and so forth, and then take that variable and use it as a control variable to ask yourself whether or not some of the variation that you're seeing is methods effect as distinct from the what's happening in the world kind of effect. I'm posing that clearly enough. You understand that? I mean, that's the same kind of thing that sometimes people who are coding data use to build in some estimate of the reliability of the data as a variable itself in the analysis.
Maybe I'll start with the second question. I haven't done that. I think that's certainly an interesting idea. I guess part of why, there are a few reasons why I'm not as concerned about the neutrality of the State Department reports. First is that I have a data set now, which I'm able to compare against other data that other people have collected. Both scholars who have collected data on reports of sexual violence in newspapers, for example, and also kind of less systematic policy reports about where sexual violence has occurred in shorter time periods. But I've checked my data against almost every other data set or list of cases that I can find. And there is very, very close agreement between my coding and these other sources. The other thing is another reason I don't feel as concerned about the data quality from the State Department is that even in cases where the U.S. is very clearly allied with one side. So a good example of this is El Salvador, which is one of my case studies, where the U.S. Spent a huge amount of resources in supporting the Salvadoran military in that case. Even in that case, and even in the context of the conflict, so reports that were coming out during the course of the conflict, the Salvadoran military is cited in the State Department reports doing a variety of really terrible things, including sexual violence, but also the signing of forced confessions, beating, and all sorts of things. So there doesn't seem to, it may have been worse than is being reported in the State Department reports, but at least in that particular case, which is a case that I know well from having conducted research on it, it doesn't seem that there is a bias against reporting those human rights violations. But I can certainly think more about collecting a more systematic variable to put into a regression. In terms of the group cohesion having, or the gang rape having decreasing marginal utility, I think that would be true if we were to assume that the makeup of the armed group stays constant. But these groups, at least in Sierra Leone where I have the best data, abduct fighters throughout the course of the war. Fighters are sometimes dying or leaving or escaping, and so there's sort of a constant need to be abducting more fighters. And so because of that, there is this constant influx of, it seems, of new fighters. And for that reason, there isn't really evidence that these groups stay static for very long.
Okay.
And so the decreasing marginal utility issue, I don't think, comes into play, at least in the case of Sierra Leone, where I have the best data.
Yeah. I think Jim touched on this when he asked his question, and forgive me if I'm repeating a question that was already asked, but I'm so curious if there's anything that suggests more legal forms of conscription or non-voluntary recruitment follow the same model. So not necessarily forced abduction of children or anything like that, but more drafting and things like that.
So when I was looking at the causes of sexual violence by states, there's nothing necessarily about my theory which would preclude conscription, the draft, from being a sort of similar mechanism to forced press ganging or forced abduction, as in the case of insurgent groups. So I did actually test that in my cross-national data, and I did not find evidence that conscription is a predictor. It was just press ganging, as I said, was really just short of significance. So which I think is quite analogous to forced abduction by insurgencies, but conscription was not. And I think one of the reasons for that may be that armies that conscript also spend a lot more time training their fighters than armies that press gang or insurgencies that abduct. And so this may be another potential variable that I haven't dealt with all that well in this particular theory, or I haven't explained fully, explored the possibilities of. I do think that training can be possibly a substitution for the kinds of bonding that happens in the course of gang rape. A lot of my understanding, at least, of a lot of the military training practices are to have the effect of creating these bonds between fighters. And so that is a potential reason why conscription did not turn out to be significant in these particular.
Could you say just a word, Dara, in that connection about, there was a tantalizing mention of the Canadian Air Force earlier.
Sure, so I was referring to a study that was done about I guess there was a scandal in Canada in the, I think it was early 90s, with the Canadian Air Force, where it became known that this particular unit had participated in these often sexualized and very humiliating bonding rituals. And so this, I believe she's a sociologist, studied this unit and tried to come up with an explanation for why this particular group had engaged in these particular rituals. And her argument was that there, because this unit was a unit that had to participate in especially dangerous activities, including jumping out of airplanes and having to depend on each other. They had a sort of need for creating bonds between each other. At least that's her explanation for why this particular unit seems to be more likely to engage in these kinds of humiliating practices. Although in that case, they did that to each other. So it wasn't against non-combatants. It was against other, maybe I should have made that more clear, against other combatants within the unit.
Well, couldn't you generalize that discussion to fraternities?
Yeah.
I mean, it seems like there's some parallels there.
Well, and also we've had scandals at the service academies. I'm involved in both men and women that have some of the same theory.
Yes. I actually... That's funny that you say that, because I have a discussion about fraternities I took out of this particular presentation, because I'm debating whether it is, I agree in some sense that it's quite similar, and there's, Peggy Reeves-Sende has a study of fraternity gang rape, which received a lot of attention in the 1990s, about very similar mechanisms to the mechanisms I'm discussing. I do think one important difference is that fraternity members are not forced. Mm-hmm. So even though they're strangers, and even though they may have this need for kind of bonding, and there is some evidence that gang rape may happen more at the beginning of a school year than it does towards the end of the school year, which again I think is maybe an implication of this kind of argument that it serves a kind of bonding function. The fact that it's not forced, I'm starting to feel less and less comfortable talking about fraternities as a sort of similar institution to prisons and armed groups, but a lot of the same features are present.
You talked about the bottom-up approach. The bottom-up approach.
Yeah.
So I'm just curious whether the rank and file carries out rape without an agreement with those at the top.
Whether they engage in rape without an agreement from those at the top?
Exactly.
So I did not find evidence of explicit orders, but I did find evidence that commanders would themselves sometimes engage in the gang rape. So there was certainly complacency or complicity in encouraging this kind of violence. Although on the flip side, there was also commanders are the ones who expressed frustration as well around this issue of sexually transmitted disease. So some commanders both participated but also were upset that it was quite costly from the perspective of their group to have so many fighters engaging in gang rape because they were getting sick. And so that was harmful to the group. So there's sort of a double-edged sword, I guess, from the perspective of the commander. But I did not find explicit orders, as I said.
Ian? Wouldn't you expect, in the presence of a stronger chain of command, there to be less rape, precisely because the rape is likely to alienate the local population and so make the achievement of your military objectives less likely to be successful? So I guess I'm puzzled that you find that it is the state forces rather than the insurgencies where the rape is more common. And maybe, I don't know if your focus on units tends to obscure those larger structural actors that should militate in favor of discipline against people who rape, but for the reasons I gave.
I do find that there are some important differences in how, or I should say where, the these types of rapes take place depending on the perpetrating group type. So I think I mentioned that it seems from the data I've collected that states are far more likely to commit sexual violence than are insurgencies, but they're also more likely to do it in kind of more private locations. So it's public in the sense that other armed actors may be present, and for this reason I would argue it still has this this bonding function that I'm arguing that it has, but it's not in front of villages or families in the way that it is in the Sierra Leone case. It's often in the context of detention against suspected insurgents, and often as kind of a repertoire of other types of tortures that are being used against those particular detainees. But I do think that there is another reason, another kind of cost from the perspective of the perpetrating group, that it would seem to, committing mass rape would seem to alienate the civilian population, which again is a kind of puzzle about what is the sort of strategic use of sexual violence from the perspective of the perpetrating group. I find sort of very little evidence that sexual violence is used as a kind of rational tool of war, at least from a strategic military perspective, that it seems to have a function more for the purpose of the armed group rather than for the purpose of winning the conflict.
Friends, an hour and 15 minutes goes by very fast, and we always end on time. I know Dara will be here for a few minutes after we break up. Thank you all for